Thirst, written by L.A. Larkin and read by John Telfer. The moral right of the author has been asserted. A few years from now. T-minus 5 days, 2 hours, 53 minutes. 5th of March, 9:07 a.m., UTC 07. Pine Island Glacier, Antarctica, 74 degrees 55 minutes south, 101 degrees 11 minutes west. At minus 30 degrees Celsius, the trickle of blood on Mac's beard froze rapidly.
What do you want?
He stammered, spread-eagled on his back. His masked attacker didn't respond. In the struggle, Mac's prescription goggles had been torn off, so the man pointing an assault rifle at him was a terrifying blur. Minutes earlier, Mac had been helping Dave to remove fragile scientific equipment from the camp's red, domed pods, known as apples. The Walgreen crevasse project was complete, and they were shutting down camp for the winter. The snowmobiles were loaded up, and Mac, chilled by the winds, had started swinging his arms and stamping his feet. His initial excitement at swapping shifts with Luke, the project's glaciologist, had waned as the intense cold clawed at his bones. Now, his heart was racing and sweat trickled down the back of his neck. His ribs had been broken by a savage blow from a rifle butt, and every breath was torture. A few meters away, near the crevasse edge, Dave lay with his arms raised, two guns trained on him. The last of the four strangers was unarmed and watched from a distance. He was the leader, it was clear from the way the others deferred to him.
Who are you?
Mac asked, dumbfounded. There were no other field sites for at least 1,000 kilometers, and he knew the nearest station Lee by was currently unmanned. Still no response. Had they heard him above the katabatic winds that hissed down the mountain and across the glacier, blowing stinging spindrift into his face? The leader moved closer. As he bent over Mac, some of his features came into focus. He rolled his balaclava up and away from his mouth, revealing thin lips and sparse black hairs on his boyish chin.
Did you report our presence here?
His voice was surprisingly deep, authoritative. Some kind of accent. American? Before Mac could answer, his interrogator gestured to the nearest subordinate, who kicked him in the kidneys. Mac convulsed, vomiting bile.
Answer! Did you radio your station?
The man yelled like a drill sergeant. Panting, and with his eyes now watering, Mac could barely make out the black blobs of his shattered two-way radio on the ground. They hadn't had time to call for help. Dressed in white, the strangers had been virtually invisible. When they appeared out of nowhere, Mac and Dave had simply gawped. In Antarctica, there was no reason to assume strangers were anything but friendly, part of the international research fraternity, and they never expected visitors to be armed.
Yes,
said Mac, hoping his lie would be believed. He had made his scheduled call to Hope Station at 0900, but that was 10 minutes ago. The man in charge glanced at the radio shards, then leaned closer to Mac's face. His small but perfect teeth were unnaturally whiter than the glacier. His eyes studied Max with clinical precision.
I don't believe you.
He smiled, stretching his lips so thin they almost disappeared.
And you're from Hope, the Australian station?
Mac just managed to shake his head, although his body shrieked in pain. The last thing he was going to do was lead them to his mates.
I see.
The man walked to where Dave lay, pocketed his working radio, and then kicked the sole of his captive's boot, as if inspecting a car's tires. Dave kicked back, but his assailant jumped aside and issued orders in a language Mac didn't understand. Two of the attackers kneeled on Dave's arms, one on each side. Young and fit, he struggled hard.
Get off me, you fuckers! Did you radio Hope Station?
The leader called to Mac. One of their attackers, wide-framed and short-legged like a bulldog, pulled off Dave's hood to reveal a mop of light blonde hair. He moved with the speed of a man used to combat.
Let me go!
Dave yelled, kicking and writhing. Mac struggled to go to the aid of his friend, but his guard shoved a rifle muzzle in his face. The broad soldier straddled Dave's chest and slapped him twice. In the second or so it took Dave to recover, his assailant took hold of his head, a hand on either side, and twisted it sharply to the right. Despite the whining wind, the crack was unmistakable. Dave no longer moved. Too late, Mac shouted.
No! No! We didn't! For God's sake! We never radioed!
As the tears ran down his face and onto the hair at his temples, they froze in tiny, pear-shaped beads of white.
That's better. Your hesitation cost your friend his life. Don't treat me like a fool.
Unable to speak, Max stared in horror as Dave, still in his safety harness, was dragged to the crevasse lip and thrown in. The ropes pinged tight as the three metallic anchors hammered deep into the ice, strained under his weight. For a fleeting moment, Mac imagined Dave hanging like a macabre marionette. Mac was yanked to his feet, the pain in his ribs like an ice pick in his side. Two men held him fast. As they pulled him towards the crevasse, Mac's terror mounted. Its mouth gaped a few meters wide, and it plunged into a deep and jagged V-shaped chasm. He managed to tear an arm free, but a rifle butt hit him between the shoulder blades, and he crumpled, yelping. Mac peered down into his turquoise tomb. Faced with imminent death, all the fight drained from him, and he released the contents of his bladder.
Please, don't, he begged. I won't say anything, for God's sake.
Do you promise?
Yes, I do, yes. Not a word. Please, I have a wife and daughter.
His captor barked instructions. Mac's smashed radio was dropped into the crevasse. Then the men used hammers to dislodge the ice screws still holding Dave's weight. Once loosened, they zipped across the surface and disappeared into the depths, taking the ropes and Dave's body with them.
A tragic accident. This poor man, the leader gestured towards the crevasse, tried to save you. But unfortunately, his anchors didn't hold. Such heroism.
No, not down there,
cried Mac, attempting to pull back from the edge.
No, don't let me die down there.
The leader placed a gloved hand on his shoulder.
My friend, this is not personal. In fact, we probably want the same thing.
He paused.
I don't want to hurt you.
Mac was released. He could barely stand, but a glimmer of hope gave him strength, and he staggered round to face his aggressor.
But you see,
said the leader, gesturing to his second in command,
it has to be done.
A kick to the stomach propelled Mac backwards, and the lip of the crevasse gave way beneath him. He was too stunned to scream. With a thud, his body bounced off an ice ledge and into the blue void. T-minus 5 days, 2 hours, 51 minutes. 5th of March, 9:09 a.m., UTC 07. The other side of the Pine Island Glacier. Suspended from a 10-meter rope as casually as if he were sitting on a swing, Luke Searle stabbed his crampons into the crevasse's glassy wall. He removed his XL-sized inner and outer gloves and ran his fingers across a striking stain in the ice. It felt as smooth as polished granite. With the care of a diamond cutter, Luke used the blade of his ice axe to chip away a tiny piece. He rolled it between his warm fingers. The ice melted slowly, releasing its gritty contents. During all his years studying ice, he had never seen anything quite like this. Engrossed by his discovery, he ignored the barely audible voice coming from the two-way radio strapped across his chest. Not only was Luke abseiling in an unknown and potentially unstable crevasse, he was alone and had not bothered to alert anyone at Hope Station to his whereabouts. Above Luke, the ice walls shone a milky, opalescent white. Below, the ice morphed from the palest sapphire blue to dark titanium. Here, the sun penetrated for the briefest of glimpses, and then only at the height of summer. In front of him, a horizontal black line as thick as his arm ran through the ice like the licorice in an allsort. A circle of ice crystals clung to his balaclava's mouth slit and to the tips of his eyelashes as the moisture in his breath froze. This was Luke's first day off in 3 months. His research into accelerated glacial flow was complete, his report submitted. But his love affair with ice didn't stop simply because his project was over. Antarctica would soon be plunged into 6 months of darkness. Before that happened, Luke wanted to investigate his theory that a subglacial volcano had erupted 2,000 years ago, dropping a layer of ash onto the ice that, over time, had been buried.
Mary. Tent. You read?
His station leader called through the radio, every few words missing. Her persistence worried him. It might be something urgent. Luke scraped some frozen ash into a sample bag, sealed it, and then ascended rapidly to the surface to improve his radio's reception.
Luke, this is Maddie on Channel 10. Do you read? Over.
Luke crawled over the lip of the crevasse and away from the fragile edge. Still on all fours, he pulled the radio close to his mouth.
Maddie, Luke here. Receive you loud and clear.
Luke, I know this is your day off, but Mac's having problems with his snowmobile and might need you to go out there and fix it. Everything's packed into the trailer, but the clutch is slipping. Over.
The overwintering team was small, so each member had to be multi-skilled, and Luke's other role was station mechanic. He checked his watch. 09:19.
No worries, Maddie. I'll give him a yell now.
Thanks, Luke. And by the way, it would be helpful if we knew where you were.
She sighed. Inside the entrance to Hope Station hung a chess-like board covered by small hooks. On every hook hung a plastic tag bearing a station member's name. When someone left or returned to the station, they had to turn their tag. There was also a book in which they were to record their name, time of departure, destination, and intended time of return. Luke had done neither.
Maddie, I can look after myself.
As if to reinforce this point, Luke rose to his full height of 6'3".
I know you can, but I need you to set an example.
Roger that.
Luke, I shouldn't be saying this on the radio, but has anyone told you what a pain in the ass you are?
He smiled.
Yes, you have, several times. Oh, and my ex, and my previous boss too, now that you mention it.
Yeah, well, at least I'm not the only station leader you pay no attention to. But we've got to work as a team here. Out.
Luke stowed his abseiling gear with expert speed, slung his pack on his back and, having removed his crampons and secured them, slid his boots into his skis bindings.
Mac, this is Luke on Channel 10. Are you receiving? Over.
He waited.
Luke to Mac. Radio check, please.
Nothing. He glanced up the mountain to the VHF repeater tower, which resembled a long ladder pointing at the sky. His signal should definitely reach the field camp because the repeater extended its range. Perhaps the silly bugger had left his radio in the field hut. He tried Dave instead, but still no response. Surely one of them should hear his voice. He tried Mac again, and at last a response came. He could barely understand it, however, because it kept cutting out, the gaps filled with brief silence. It sounded like,
Mac to Luke, receiving you weak and intermittent.
Over.
Mac, what's wrong with your snowmobile? Over.
A pause.
What? You mean?
You radioed in. Is the clutch slipping again?
Negative. The clutch is...
Then nothing.
Mac, can you repeat?
The clutch is fine.
Luke frowned, surprised. Maddie wouldn't have asked him to check if it hadn't been important.
You sure?
Clutch working now.
Still the voice kept dropping out.
Roger that. Mate, you sound like your head's in a bucket of water. I can hardly hear you.
ETA still midday? Mac, to Luke, midday.
Roger that. Radio me if you have any problems.
Will do. Out.
This was odd, but Luke decided to give Mac another call once he was back at the station. Half an hour later, Luke slid to a stop and removed his balaclava and goggles to reveal blue-grey eyes, prominent cheekbones, and weathered olive skin, which belied his 30 years. His unruly black hair was sorely in need of a cut. His home for the last 5 months was a structure raised above the ice on 16 hydraulic legs. Hope Station's silver metal skin gleamed in the anemic sun. From where Luke stood, it looked like a cross between a giant silverfish and the Eagle lunar lander. All the living and working quarters were under one roof. The fuel tank, wind turbine, water recycling plant, fire hut, and satellite dish were separate from the main building. The station was positioned to one side of the mighty Pine Island Glacier and faced the sea. At least it did in the summer. It was now Antarctica's autumn, and the fractured sea ice was fast thickening into an impenetrable barrier. In a few weeks, Pine Island Bay would be covered in an unyielding icy crust. It swelled out from the continent so much that, in the depths of winter, Antarctica bloated to double its size. Luke closed his eyes. All he could hear was the occasional pop and crack as mountain ice surrendered to gravity, moving imperceptibly downhill towards the glacier. The stillness filled him with an energy that made his skin tingle, as if every cell in his body was being recharged. In Antarctica, especially when he was away from the day-to-day clatter and chatter of cramped station life, he felt exhilarated. Here, his thoughts had a pristine clarity. He inhaled the sparkling sub-zero air and opened his eyes. Leaning on his ski poles, he gazed in admiration at the glacier's endless white moonscape, which reached deep into the heart of the vast West Antarctic ice sheet. In the opposite direction, it met the Amundsen Sea, its giant ice tongue extending out over the water as if it were licking the salty brine. The last supply ship had left a week ago, not to return until October. Maddie Wildman, the ball-breaking station leader, had waved a confident farewell to the icebreaker's crew, the pom-poms on her fleece hat swinging as her arms described wide arcs. But Luke had seen her apprehensive glance at Craig, the oldest of the overwinterers, before she beamed a huge smile again. Craig had his arms folded across his knitted by my wife it's ghastly but I love her jumper. Tubbs, the youngest, was all bravado. He had dropped his pants and received a blast from the ship's horn in response. But once the ship was nothing more than a smudge in the distance, Tubbs had gone unusually quiet. Over the years, Luke had watched the ship depart with relief. For him, Antarctica was home. But since the birth of his son, Jason, this relief had been tinged with guilt, and more recently, with apprehension. There was something his six-year-old was keeping from him. As Luke pulled on his headgear and skied downhill, he felt an urgent need to talk to him. But given the time difference, that would have to wait a few hours. He deftly wove around rocky outcrops until he was within hailing distance of the station. Craig waved at him from the top of a ladder where he was working on the roof of the fire hut, which housed emergency fire equipment and survival supplies. He was the station carpenter and fire chief. As Luke headed towards Craig, three black and white Adélie penguins cut across his path. Beaks first, they slid on their bellies down the gentle incline towards the beach, oblivious to Luke's presence.
"Hey, mate,"
Luke called out to Craig.
"Need some help?"
"Ah, I'm just about done here. You, on the other hand, might need some yourself."
Craig jerked his head behind him. Luke glanced at the station, searching for a clue. Everything looked normal, including the Australian flag, which had been snap-frozen mid-flap for the last few weeks.
"Maddie wants to see you."
Craig climbed down the ladder, nimble for a man in his early 50s, and slapped Luke's shoulder.
"Good luck,"
he said with a mischievous smile. Luke nodded and hurried on. Before he'd even removed his skis, he heard Maddie's husky voice calling his name. She always sounded as if she'd been shouting above nightclub music all night, but nothing could be further from the truth. Expecting a reprimand, his grip on his ski poles tightened a fraction. He peered up at the metal walkway which ran the length of the raised building. Maddie leaned over the railing and looked down at him. Her copper-coloured hair spiralled out from under her beanie and over her shoulders.
"Congratulations, Luke,"
she said.
"Your paper on dynamic thinning won the Seligman Crystal Award. We're very proud of you."
She smiled and carefully stepped down the slick steps. Luke tore off his balaclava.
"It did?"
he asked, incredulous.
"Yes, and so it should have. I haven't told the others yet. Wanted to let you know first. We'll be having a big celebration tonight."
"Woo-hoo!" Luke punched the air. He couldn't wait to tell Jason. Maddie was 5'8", muscular and slim. She adopted a no-nonsense stance with arms folded as her green eyes scanned his face.
"Did you talk to Mac?"
"Yeah, he said the clutch was working again, but I think I'd better get over there and check it out for myself."
"No need. If he said it's fine, I'm sure it is. Let's not waste fuel on an unnecessary trip."
Luke hesitated, wondering if it was worth arguing. They already disagreed over so many issues.
"Okay, you're the boss,"
he replied, raising his arms in surrender. Still, something didn't feel right. T-minus 5 days, 1 hour, 50 minutes. 5th of March, 10:10 a.m, UTC 07. 74 degrees 52 minutes south, 100 degrees 30 minutes west. To Robert Zhao Sheng, Antarctica was a hellhole, made only just bearable by his executive chef and the billions he would earn exploiting it. He dabbed his mouth with a napkin and pushed away his half-eaten breakfast, porridge liberally sprinkled with brown sugar. His lip curled in disgust at the muddy black coffee. How he longed for Earth Florentine and a double shot espresso. His chef did his best, but after weeks of frozen, dehydrated, and boil in a bag meals, Robert was suffering real hardship. Much like Robert Falcon Scott, whose diary he had been reading on his iPad. As he leaned back in his chair, he grinned. How his competitors would squirm with jealousy when his story of courage and survival in Antarctica was on the front page of the Wall Street Journal. He glanced at his video camera, still on its tripod at one end of his 10-person super-insulated Weatherhaven tent. He was recording history in the making. It would be wall-to-wall coverage on all networks.
"Ha!"
he said, throwing his head back. In the world of private equity, this was unique. No one else would be able to tell of survival against such odds, of personally leading a pioneering project that would bring the world an invaluable resource, not to mention make him more money than he could ever spend. But spending it wasn't the point. As they say, he who has the most when he dies wins. Robert frowned. The winds roaring down the Hudson Mountains buffeted his tent and intruded on his reverie. He glanced at his new platinum Jean Dunant watch, the only one in the world which had cost a little shy of $800,000. He had 4 minutes until a call with his father, General Zhao Yun, a fellow investor in his brainchild. Robert turned up the volume of Vivaldi's L'Inverno Concerto from the Four Seasons to drown out the wind's annoying moan. He stared down at the heater at his feet and thought of the times he'd looked down from his luxurious office at the jungle of Hong Kong's streets. As senior managing director and chief investment officer of the Hood Group, a global private equity firm, Robert's job was to find opportunity in chaos, gold in the dross. He liked to target companies in trouble and force them to sell. Not only was it vastly profitable if done well, and Robert did it very well indeed, but it was fun watching them trying to squirm out of his embrace. Of course, he did it with style and panache, even if behind the scenes his staff would schmooze, blackmail, or intimidate, whatever it took, to ensure that the Hood Group maintained its reputation as the private equity firm of the Orient. Occasionally, there were murmurings about the Hood Group going too far with the politicians or the press, spokespeople for the great unwashed masses calling them a vulture fund. But Robert was no ordinary predator. He had built the largest corporate art collection in the region, sponsored the symphony orchestra, and his foundation contributed to a portfolio of worthy causes. Patrons like him were needed, even if the ungrateful recipients despised what he did. His philanthropy was a reminder to all of his wealth and power, and, most of all, of his impeccable taste. Robert smiled to himself. "I put the private back into private equity," he said aloud, not caring if his men outside heard. He loved to boast that a significant proportion of his company's capital came from individuals, the new and rapidly growing class of Chinese billionaires. It was time. Robert silenced the music, wishing he could silence the winds too. He was reminded of a production of King Lear he saw when last in London, in which the old king raged against the winds. Robert brushed the thought from his mind. The king was a fool and should never have given away his kingdom. Robert glanced in the mirror and combed his hair, parted slightly right of centre, Clark Kent style. He was less well-kempt than usual, but thought he looked rugged, like a great Antarctic explorer should. Robert dialed into the secure teleconference and nodded at his father's image, which filled the screen. It was after midnight in Beijing, though the general still wore the pine-green uniform of the People's Liberation Army. He dropped his chin a fraction in acknowledgement of his son, their traditional, heartfelt greeting. Robert's interactions with his father were like strategic moves in the Chinese board game of Go, each constantly trying to outwit the other.
"So you ordered your first kill. Congratulations, my son," said the general. "Did you enjoy it?"
"No, father, I did not. Their deaths were unnecessary. Captain Wei made an error."
It was hard to look imposing in the skin-tight thermals that stretched over Robert's puny body, but he leaned towards the screen, trying to fill it. The general raised a greying eyebrow, looking at Robert over the frames of his bifocals, which rested high on the puffy skin of his cheekbones.
"I doubt it."
Robert had never seen any warmth in his father's eyes, let alone any sign of approval. It didn't matter to the general that in the financial world Robert was famous, or rather infamous, or that his net worth could wipe out the debt of many third world countries.
"My men are under strict instructions to keep away from Hope Station people," Robert replied. "Two of Wei's soldiers were at the Fitzgerald fissure. We believe McNamara and Cox spotted their snowmobiles. They should have taken more care to conceal them."
From what I hear, the Australians were racing their snowmobiles and strayed from their Walgreen Crevasse campsite.
As usual, Robert kept his partly lame left hand hidden under his right. His grip tightened, his knuckles whitened.
Father, I know that Gao Wei was once under your command, but now he reports to me. He can have only one commander. He works for Hung Security, and I selected him for this job,
the general growled.
And I own Hung Security. So I own Captain Wei.
The mercenaries with Robert were from a private security and military contractor, one of the Hood Group's investee companies. A number of them, including Captain Wei, had been in the People's Liberation Army and had never forgotten what the general had done for them.
Do I have to remind you, son, that you are a civilian commanding some of the most highly skilled soldiers in the world? And you are doing so because of me? If I wish to talk to Wei, I will do so. This is my project.
Robert began to grind his teeth.
This is war, Robert. We cannot be discovered.
It's business, Father, and I like to use a little more subtlety. His breakfast churned in his stomach.
They had to die.
The general paused.
So do the others. No. We can jam their communications. They won't be able to tell anyone anything. The hacker is trustworthy.
Totally. I've used him many times. He used to work for our government. Goes by the name of I.
I?
Yes. An affectation.
He can look into anybody's system, no matter how secure. He's hacked into the Pentagon several times. And how long will the jammer last?
Maximum 18 hours.
Not long enough. You know what you have to do, and I expect you to do it.
The general ended the call. Robert stood suddenly, and his chair fell backwards. He grabbed a two-way radio and yelled into it.
Captain Wei! In my tent, now!
Wei soon appeared, dressed in a white parka and waterproof trousers. He didn't salute, but stood to attention. His frame was wide and squat, his face flat and hard. His small eyes appeared like black marbles.
Sir,
Captain Wei said,
the two idiots who allowed themselves to be seen by the Australians have caused us a great deal of trouble. Halve their food rations. Sir, in these sub-zero temperatures, if their rations are halved, they won't have the energy to do their job. 2 days, half rations, and I expect them to do their job perfectly. Now leave.
Robert righted his chair and sat down, ready for his next call. He might be stuck in the middle of nowhere, but he still had a portfolio to run. He didn't need the video conferencing facility, so he used his satellite phone to call the chairman of the largest missile manufacturing company in Asia, an idiot who'd had the audacity to reject Robert's offer to buy the floundering company. How could anyone fail to make money from missiles?
Who is this?
The voice was sleepy. Robert introduced himself in Mandarin, the preferred language of the chairman, but he could just as easily converse in Cantonese or English.
How dare you call me in the middle of the night?
Listen to me. I'm going to buy your company, Robert answered. I've got money and time. I am patient. But next time, I'll be buying it for half what's on the table today.
The contempt in his voice was unmistakable.
I repeat, said the chairman, the company is not for sale. You're in trouble, and believe me, I can add to the pressure. Your share price is down 30% in 3 months. Who knows how long your banks will be patient? Time is ticking. You will sell.
Grinning, Robert ended the call and made a mental note to organize a press leak about a board member's fondness for expensive call girls. He then cranked up his Vivaldi and returned his attention to Hope Station. The problem for its remaining residents was that their time was running out too.
T-5 days, 1 hour, 34 minutes. 5th of March,
10:26 a.m., UTC 07. Hope Station, 75 degrees, 10 minutes south, 102 degrees, 3 minutes west. In the lab, Luke found that his sample's chemical composition was remarkably similar to that of volcanic ash from Mount Erebus, Antarctica's most active volcano. But Erebus was well over 1,000 kilometers away. Excited, he decided to return to the crevasse tomorrow with his field assistant, Dave. On his way to a storage facility, Luke ducked into his room. When he turned, he found Maddie standing in his doorway.
"Can I come in?" she asked.
Luke involuntarily clenched his jaw. Maddie lived her life on station with the predictability of a metronome, whereas he was as unpredictable as spindrift, blowing every which way. They seldom saw eye to eye.
"Sure."
He gestured towards the chair. As Maddie entered, her eyes darted to the wall above his bed. Luke saw a pained expression flicker across her face. There were no photos of people in his room. His only one of his son was in a drawer. On his walls were four crayon drawings, each signed Jace in large wobbly letters. In one, there were two stick people, a little boy and his mum with long yellow hair. They stood next to a square house with a triangular red roof. At the edge of the page, another stick figure sat alone in a large yellow circle next to an igloo-shaped house with blue waves encircling the island. This, Jason had decided, was where Daddy lived, not realizing there were no Inuit in Antarctica. The paintings reminded Luke that Jason had been unusually cagey when they'd last spoken.
"Luke, you okay?"
asked Maddie.
"Fine,"
he said, focusing back on her.
"I said amazing photo."
She nodded at a photograph of an albatross.
"I remember that one. Followed the ship for 3 days.
Luke raised his eyebrows.
"Coming from an ornithologist, I'll take that as a compliment."
Maddie had several roles, including station leader and microbiologist, but in what little spare time she had, she loved to study Antarctica's bird life.
"Ornithology's just a hobby.
Look, sorry if I've been a bit abrupt lately.
Got a lot on my mind."
"You mean the bird flu?" asked Luke, relaxing. The one thing they did have in common was a love of birds.
"Yes. I can't believe it's reached Antarctica."
She brushed away a speck of something on her arm, as if trying to brush away her anxiety.
"What did Charlie say? Have you heard any more from him?"
Maddie cupped her chin in her hands.
"Well, it's kind of bizarre," she said. "I've known him years, but since he arrived at Whaler's Island, he's gone all weird."
"Maybe he feels he can't tell you everything, that it would upset you."
"I'm already upset, Luke. There are 100,000 pairs of Adélie penguins nesting there. Quarantining the whole island is a tough call. I mean, you can't stop them fishing. They need to eat. And so the flu spreads."
"So what was weird about Charlie?"
"His last email was stuffy, kind of formal. Then I heard nothing. He's not replying to any of my emails."
"Okay. It's not like him."
"I'd give anything to go over there and help out."
Whaler's Island was in the Amundsen Sea, 20 nautical miles away.
"You want to check it out? I'll take you there."
"Are you serious?"
Her voice was high-pitched with excitement. Then she shook her head.
"No, I can't do it. I don't have time to waste on a jolly."
"But this outbreak could decimate penguin populations."
"I know. But we can't go on the island."
"No, we stay in the boat and keep a safe distance. But at least you could see Charlie and talk through the radio."
He watched her consider his offer. Whenever she was unsure how to respond, she twisted her hair into a bun and secured it with whatever was to hand. This time, it was a pen. He always wondered how it stayed put.
"Too risky, Luke. And I should just get on with running the station."
She stood and headed for the door.
"Oh, well done again for winning the prize. You annoy the hell out of me most of the time, but I'm very proud of you."
Maddie left before he could respond, almost colliding with Tubbs. The station chef charged into the room. His head of blonde curls, his dimpled smile, and his short, plump body gave him the appearance of a mischievous cherub.
"Hey, my man,"
he said, high-fiving Luke.
"The award thing is awesome."
"How did you..." The grapevine was as fast as ever. "Thanks." Tubbs, who was always on hyperdrive, continued.
"So, party tonight? Cooking up a feast, big juicy steaks, medium rare, just how you like them."
Tubbs rubbed his pudgy hands together in excitement. Luke couldn't help but laugh.
"I hope to God Maddie doesn't make a speech."
"She has to. From what I hear, this is a big deal. So, you're a rich man now?"
Deep in thought, Luke didn't answer.
"Hello? Anybody there?" said Tubbs. "I said, any prize money?"
"Yeah, but I won't be spending it."
"Are you kidding me?"
Luke stood, dwarfing his friend, and smiled.
"Fancy a boat trip?"
T-minus 5 days, 1 hour, 1 minute. 5th of March, 10:59 a.m., UTC 07.
"What would you know about the risk I'm taking?"
sneered the general.
"All you do is play with numbers."
Only his father would dare to speak to him like that. Robert's boot swung back and forth in irritation, tapping the makeshift floor of his tent. He felt like punching the monitor that framed his father's bloated face. Instead, he took a deep breath.
"Wrong, father. I make things happen. Things other people consider impossible. And I make a fortune from it. My good investments make so much money that the inevitable losses are just the price of doing business. You talk about risk, father? Well, risk is my life. You think this man in Sydney threatens our project? Then, yes, we must eliminate that risk. But another death? Why not just keep him quiet until the 10th of March? It won't matter after that.
Son, you focus on making this project a success. I'll send King to deal with it."
Robert had heard of King, a Caucasian operative his father had used before. He moved on quickly.
"Father, I've always made it very clear this project is a high-risk venture. Our new technology could fail, our costs could blow out, or the international community could stop our operations. Any number of things could go wrong. This has never been done before. But private equity is a high-wire act. Only someone as smart and experienced as me, only someone with my connections and resources could have spotted this potential gold mine in Antarctica. We're on the verge of launching a whole new industry. Never before has this resource been so desperately needed, nor has anyone invested the millions necessary to make it happen. We will be national heroes."
Robert's gaunt face stretched into a triumphant smile.
"That's all very well," the general replied. "But it must make us rich. Rich enough to be safe. For you, this is merely a business venture. I, on the other hand, have put my life on the line. I have gone behind the party's back. Only a few hand-picked men know. If word gets out, I could be tried for treason."
"Nerves of steel, father."
"Don't patronize me, you paper pusher."
Robert had only ever heard panic in his father's belligerent voice once before, and that was when he had discovered his wife dead.
"I have staked my reputation, father, and when you have $160 billion under management, as I do, reputation is everything. It was that reputation that got us the $400 million to make this project happen."
"Don't lecture me, boy. In the scheme of things, $400 million is small fry to you."
"True, but we won't fail."
Robert waited for his father's phlegmy, agitated breathing to slow down.
"So, what are you doing about Hope Station?"
the general growled. For once, the winds had died down, and Robert's tent, which resembled an oversized 44-gallon drum cut in half and laid on its side, felt too quiet, and his father's voice too loud.
My hacker has been monitoring all their communications. The alarm hasn't been raised. The jammer is about to be activated, and I have a plan to deal with the 6 residents.
We'll get on with it,
grumbled the general.
And watch out for Luke Searle. I have read his file. He lacks discipline and challenges his superiors, but he's a born survivor. 7 seasons in Antarctica. Experienced mountaineer, has trekked through the Karakoram. He survived a 3-day storm by digging an ice cave.
Thanks to his hacker, Robert had watched Searle's email traffic and paid particular attention to his regular Skype calls to his son. In any campaign, Robert always tried to identify his enemy's weaknesses. Searle's was his son, but Robert would keep that to himself for now. If his plan worked, there would be no need to exploit it.
I agree, but Madeline Wildman is the leader. She is disciplined. Tough.
Bah! A woman. Don't be ridiculous. Now, eliminate them, or I will order Captain Wei to do it.
As their phone conversation ended, Wei's voice barked over the two-way radio.
Captain Oates to Commander Scott. Permission to wake the baby.
It was Robert's idea to adopt the names of Robert Falcon Scott's team. It was unlikely their radio transmissions would be overheard, but this way their identities were safeguarded. Besides, he enjoyed the association with the heroic Scott. Wei's message meant that he was within a kilometer of Hope Station and ready to activate the jammer. The captain wouldn't be spotted. His white parka, hood, and salopettes gave him more than adequate camouflage.
Scott to Oates. Permission granted.
In his mind's eye, Robert could see the small wooden crate filled with fancy dress clothing stored at Hope Station. Hidden inside was a radio and satellite jammer, placed there many months ago by King, who had also planted key loggers into 3 laptops bound for Hope Station so that Robert could monitor the keystrokes of Searle, Wildman, and the now-dead communications officer McNamara. The jammer resembled an early brick mobile phone, but instead of 1 long antenna, it had 4. King had selected the fancy dress crate because he knew its contents were unlikely to be opened until the winter solstice celebration on the 21st of June, by which time his employer's mission would be complete.
"The baby is awake, sir,"
said Wei. Robert turned to his communications officer, Huang Feng.
"So it'll jam for 18 hours if it's inside in the warm, but what if it's stored outside? How long then?"
Huang was almost hidden by the laptops, sat phones, handheld GPS and GPR units, surveillance binoculars, and other equipment that was piled on his table.
"Batteries don't cope well in extreme cold. It could be as little as 6.
"But it will block all frequency bands?"
"All those used at Hope, yes." Huang looked at his monitors and scratched his shaved head.
"Oh, sir, the jammer doesn't appear to be working."
"Why not?"
asked Robert, his voice perfectly calm.
I don't know yet, sir. The battery could be dislodged or perhaps drained."
Huang looked nervously askance at his commander.
I'm working on it, sir."
Robert radioed Wei.
"Captain Oates, are you sure the baby's awake? Confirm."
Wei responded with an affirmative.
"The baby appears dead," Robert told him. "Keep one of your men on watch. If a search party leaves Hope, alert me."
"Will do, sir."
Robert now addressed Huang.
"If it's the battery, how do we solve it?"
"Someone has to find the jammer and replace the battery, which means entering the station."
"Time to call in a favor."
T-minus 5 days, 29 minutes. 5th of March, 11:31 a.m, UTC 07. Luke blinked, his thick black eyelashes sweeping away the sting of salt. Dodging chunks of sea ice, he managed to keep the 12-person inflatable rubber boat, a Zodiac, at a reasonable speed as they approached the brooding bulk of Whaler's Island. Circular in shape, the island was a volcanic caldera, with asphalt-grey, icy crags punctuated by bleak beaches of black volcanic sand. A burst of red between the jumble of icebergs and smaller bergy bits caught Luke's eye. He squinted into the murky distance. It had to be the Professor Basov. She was always the last tourist ship of the season and usually dropped anchor for one night inside the island's hidden harbour. But with the bird flu outbreak, she had clearly kept a safe distance. Luke had hoped the Basov might be in the area, a chance to catch up with his mate, Vitaly Yushkov. He wiped his sunglasses with a gloved hand and placed them back on his wind-chafed face. Tubbs sat on the bulbous side of the boat, grinning with delight, with one hand gripping the rope. Luke revved the engine and leaned into the rush of air, one leg forward to stabilize himself. The sun broke through the clouds and lit up the submerged section of a truck-sized piece of floating ice, which glowed a dazzling turquoise. A 3-meter leopard seal sunbathed on the icy raft. Its mouth, wide enough to engulf Luke's head, seemed fixed in a permanent joker's grin.
"Look at the size of that!"
called Tubbs, pointing.
"They get even bigger!"
Luke shouted back.
"The females can reach almost 4 meters.
The seal, so sleek and fast in the water, lumbered towards the ice's edge and slid in. As they moved around a 3-story-high iceberg shaped like a dented teapot, the predominantly white Professor Basov was revealed. Now Luke could clearly see the brightly painted funnel with its horizontal stripes alternating red, blue, and black, and the garish red lifeboats raised high on the upper deck. The icebreaker, 5 stories high, with rust stains down its bow like a nosebleed, had dropped anchor. Luke spied tiny figures on the decks and knew the tourists were enjoying the breathtaking views. As they approached the vessel, Luke spotted Vitaly Yushkov leaning on the railing at the stern. Over his powerful wrestler's body, the tall Russian wore a navy blue boiler suit, from which a wide neck and a head of closely cropped fair hair protruded. Despite the cold, his head and hands weren't covered. He was smoking a cigarette, which he stubbed out on the deck under his salt-stained boots and kicked the stub into the ocean. When Luke was close enough, he hollered,
"Hey! Stop littering, you old bastard!"
Vitaly didn't deign to respond. He didn't even move his head, but he must have glanced down in their direction as he straightened and waved his muscular arms in the air. Luke waved back and used his 2-way radio to request permission to board the ship. The gangway was lowered, and with the Zodiac safely secured, Luke and Tubbs went aboard. They stepped into a shallow pool of disinfectant to ensure they didn't contribute to the spread of any infectious diseases. Vitaly opened his arms wide and caught Luke in a bear hug.
"My friend, good to see you."
He pushed Luke away as quickly as he had embraced him.
"You bring me a gift?"
he demanded, folding his arms across his broad chest.
"What? So you can litter the ocean some more?"
laughed Luke.
"Now why would I do that?"
Luke unzipped his windproof jacket and retrieved a packet of cigarettes from his inner pocket.
"But I guess if you want to kill yourself, who am I to stop you?"
he joked, as he threw the packet at Vitaly.
"Ha!"
said Vitaly, as if to say he knew all along that Luke had them concealed on his person. He popped the cigarettes in his boiler suit pocket. His sapphire blue eyes then focused on Tubbs.
This is Tubbs, the best station chef I've ever known. He can really cook," said Luke. "Tubbs, this is my good friend Vitaly Yushkov. I did a stint as a tour guide on this ship. If it hadn't been for Vitaly, I'd have thrown myself overboard."
Luke glanced up at the tourists watching them, thankful he was not at their beck and call.
"If you are a friend of this big guy, then you are also my friend,"
said Vitaly, embracing Tubbs, who wriggled free as soon as he could without offending the Russian. He wasn't comfortable with man-on-man hugging. The arrival of 2 strangers had captured the attention of several guests who were hovering nearby, whispering to each other in their diverse languages. But because the Russian crew didn't fraternize with the tourists, the onlookers kept a polite distance.
"Why you come here?"
Vitaly asked.
Luke smiled. Vitali had always been direct.
I wanted to take a look at whalers and talk to Charlie, our guy in charge of the quarantine. You know, see how he's going,
he said, moving to the starboard side of the ship. Vitali and Tubbs followed.
We cannot visit the island, Vitali said. It is this bird flu. The tourists, they are not happy.
Luke nodded and tried to raise Charlie on the radio. No response. He frowned.
Must be out of range. I'll try later.
He looked at Vitali.
How about a coffee?
Of course.
Still like paint stripper?
Worse. I'll take you to captain first.
Vitali then clomped up the steel steps of each deck until he reached the bridge. It was midday, way too early for Captain Dmitry Bolshakov to be at the helm, Luke thought. He had expected the captain to be sleeping off the alcohol that ran through his veins pretty much 24/7. Luke stepped forward to shake his hand.
Luke!
From behind his white handlebar moustache and ruddy, pockmarked skin, Bolshakov smiled. He wore a light camel-coloured uniform, complete with gold-braided insignia on his epaulets. Luke could smell the alcohol on his breath. The bridge was warm, the old radiator still pumping out a comfortable heat. Luke gazed around. Nothing had changed since his time on the Busov. The heavy grey equipment with large dials dated the ship to the 1980s. She'd been built in St. Petersburg.
Still deftly steering the ship away from danger? Luke said.
He remembered seeing the captain stand steady as his ship corkscrewed through terrifying seas, despite having consumed a bottle of vodka a few hours before. Bolshakov shrugged.
Of course. So you visit us. Why?
At that moment, a short-haired, compact man with bulbous eyes entered. He moved with the agility of an athlete, each step a controlled bounce.
I saw you come on board. I'm Alrik Dengen, from Norway. Have you come from Wales?
His English was near perfect, educated, fast-paced, no nonsense. Alrik put out his hand to shake Luke's and then thought better of it. The hand was swiftly retracted.
No, Hope Station. Luke Searle and Warren Grigg.
Luke used Tubbs' real name.
So there's no danger we've brought the virus on board,
said Luke, anticipating Alrik's concern.
Good,
Alrik said, shaking their hands in turn with newfound enthusiasm. He then took a step back and fidgeted from foot to foot. He clearly had more energy than he could expend.
Didn't want the ship quarantined, you know. Must keep the guests happy.
So, he asked, waiting for Luke to explain his uninvited presence.
Visiting our friends,
Luke responded, flicking a smile at Vitali and Bolshakov.
And I was wondering if you'd seen any activity on whalers.
Our station leader is worried. Communication with the RO quarantine team has been limited.
RO?
Asked Vitali, misunderstanding the acronym.
Short for Australian Antarctic Research Organisation, Luke clarified.
Bolshakov handed Luke the binoculars.
You look.
The bridge afforded Luke a high vantage point. He scanned the nearest beach and could make out small black and white feathery bodies strewn over the grey sand. He swallowed hard. It looked like a massacre. Maddie would be devastated.
Alrik said, I've seen men in orange coats walking along the beach.
Luke felt reassured that men wearing Aro colours had been seen. He was about to radio Charlie again on the island when he heard Maddie's voice.
Luke, Tubbs, this is Maddie. Do you read? Over.
Luke pulled the radio close.
Maddie, Luke here. Receive you loud and clear.
Where the hell are you?
Tubbs winced. She didn't sound happy. Luke could hear Vitali chuckling behind him.
On the Professor Bassoff, he replied. Checking out Whaler's Island.
Shit, Luke. I made it clear you were to go there.
Luke saw Alrik raise an eyebrow.
Sure, he thought she hadn't wanted to go, but he knew Maddie would see this as another example of his impetuousness.
Maybe now was not the time to point out that he had turned his tag and written clearly and neatly his intention to visit Whaler's Island in the book.
"Luke, we need you back here now," she went on. "Mac and Dave haven't come back, and they're not responding to radio contact."
T-minus 4 days, 22 hours, 40 minutes. 5th of March, 1:20 p.m., UTC 07. Luke had 10 minutes before the briefing. He tore off his salt-spattered parka and went to Skype, hoping Jason might be online earlier than they'd arranged. He was.
"Hey, little buddy,"
Luke said, staring into his son's questioning eyes that were so similar to his own. Like his father, Jason preferred to observe people rather than engage with them. Jason's laptop was on a low plastic table, so Luke's view of his bedroom was limited to a glimpse of a sheet with penguins on it and a large green Lego tractor sitting on the floor.
"Look what I did."
Jason disappeared from view. A few seconds later, he returned with what looked like a boat made of cardboard, painted orange, with black portholes, which he placed between himself and the monitor so that Luke could barely see the boy's face.
"The big orange!"
Jason shouted and giggled. As it was Sunday and only 7:22 a.m. in Melbourne, Jessica was probably still asleep, but Luke didn't want to dampen his son's excitement.
"The Aura Australis. That's fantastic, Jace. Did you make it at school?"
Jason nodded, his face bobbing in and out of view.
"Tell me this story, Daddy."
Luke checked the screen clock. He didn't have time, but his son's eager face won him over. Luke's fondest memory was of story time when Jason would snuggle under his arm and gaze up at him, open-mouthed.
"There's a very big ship that's painted bright orange, and it's called
the Big Orange."
"That's right. And it travels to a land of ice called..."
He waited for Jason to chip in.
"Antarctica."
"Antarctica, yes. And the icebreaker goes up onto the sea ice, and then it crashes down and cracks it.
Boom, boom, boom,"
Jason shouted. Jessica wouldn't be asleep for much longer. Luke raised his finger to his mouth as if to say,
"Hush," and continued, "And on the sea ice live lots of seals and..."
A woman's voice cut in.
"Keep the noise down, will you?"
Then she leaned over Jason and pushed aside the cardboard ship so she could see Luke.
"If you have to talk this early, can you try not to get him so excited?"
Despite her scowl and their unhappy history, Luke was still drawn to her translucent skin and full lips. Before he could say anything, she continued,
"We need to talk, but not now. Finish up, will you?"
"Jess?"
called Luke. Luke heard her voice, and then a man's. Or was it the radio? Jason frowned.
"What's the matter, Jace?"
Jason looked down and wriggled about in his chair.
Luke knew he shouldn't ask his son the question, but he had to know. "Does Mummy have a friend staying?"
Jason looked around the room, chewing his lip, and then nodded.
"Time to stop,"
said Jessica from the doorway.
"Say goodbye." "Bye, Daddy."
"Bye, Jace. Love you."
Jessica severed the connection. Luke glanced at his hand on the mouse. It was shaking.
"Briefing,"
Maddie called from the door.
"In the dining room, now."
She was gone. Luke stood. His legs quivered as if he'd run a marathon. He had broken out in a sweat, and his thermals clung to him. Craig passed his doorway.
"Hurry up, mate."
In a daze, Luke changed his top and then ran down the corridor. In the dining room, the tension was palpable. Even Luke, who was calm when it came to rescues, felt his stomach tighten when he entered. Tubbs was leaning against the wall, his folded arms resting on his ballooning stomach. Luke slid onto a bench. Sue Sadri, the plumber, plonked down next to him. He received a static shock as her arm brushed his. She stayed close regardless, gnawing at what remained of a fingernail. Short and squat, with a tattooed neck, she resembled a wrestler in pink. Craig was opposite them with a mug of tea in his calloused hands. Maddie stood in front of the group, hands on her hips. The doctor, Frank Stone, was not far from her side. He was a man who took particular pride in his long, bushy beard, trimming it each morning as if he were training a bonsai. As a result, he'd earned the nickname Bluebeard, shortened to Blue.
"It's now 4 hours of zero radio contact," Maddie began, "and an hour and a half since Mac and Dave missed their midday return to station deadline. Given how reliable Mac is," Maddie glanced at Luke as if to emphasize the difference between the two men, "we're now into SAR, a search and rescue. At this stage, I'm not going to send more than 3 people out."
Her voice reverberated across the near-empty dining room. It was built to seat 40. The 6 who were present scarcely filled one corner.
"Luke is leader. Blue, I'd like you to go on this one. And Craig."
Luke looked up, frowning in surprise. She looked at him again.
"Yes, Luke, I'd like you to lead. You know the Walgreen crevasse better than anyone, and you're the most experienced abseiler. If they're in trouble down there, we'll need your skills to get them out."
Very few people had ever set foot on the Pine Island Glacier, or Pig, as it was affectionately known. Luke had spent more time exploring its 250-by-40-kilometre expanse than any other person. Even their Chinese neighbours and friends at Lebi Station spent most of their time focusing on the West Antarctic ice sheet, and only one of their scientists had ever joined Luke on site. Luke knew all about the glacier's dangers, including the Walgreen, or Wall, a jagged crevasse that ran inland for 10 kilometres, where Mac and Dave had been shutting up shop for the winter.
"I need you to stick to SAR protocols. No deviations. Got it?"
"Got it," Luke replied. "Has a locator beacon been activated?"
All Hope Station vehicles had these. Once a beacon was activated, any of the other station vehicles would be able to locate them.
"Nope."
Curious, he thought. Maddie began her briefing. Luke knew she had to issue instructions and run through safety procedures, but time was wasting.
"Maddie," he cut in, "we have plenty of light to get there today. Clear skies and the sun's low angle means we'll get nice long shadows, so no problem spotting slots. We should get going."
Shadows from icy peaks and troughs sometimes indicated a crevasse hidden under a shallow layer of snow, sometimes called a slot.
"There's a storm brewing to the south that could be heading our way. I want to wait an hour to check its direction."
"I don't want to wait," replied Luke.
He noticed out of the corner of his eye Sue's jaw drop slightly. He shook his head, struggling to be diplomatic.
I'm worried. If there's been an accident, the faster we get there, the better."
"I agree," Maddie replied. "But a SAR in a blizzard is too dangerous."
"It'll take an hour to reach the camp. We've got to get going now. If we wait and the storm hits..."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.